The heroes have prepared for this moment. The nuns at the convent have been harassed by Voltan's men for too long now. The thugs begin their assault, and the heroes leap into action. It's a hard fight. The bandits outnumber the heroes 3-1, and the heroes have to worry about keeping the nuns safe. It looks like there is no hope, but then Hawk catches a glimpse of Voltan's son. With a deft maneuver, Hawk manages to slay his foe. The thugs are now leaderless and unwilling to press the fight. It's a victory for now, but the abbey is not safe yet. Voltan will soon learn of his son's death, and his vengeance will be swift. Hello, Internet. I'm Steven the DM, and this is Basic Dungeoneering, where I help you take your game to the next level. Today we'll be continuing our tips for combat, this time focusing on objectives and non-standard win conditions. We'll be putting your players in situations similar to Hawk's, where they'll have to contend with defending the innocent while finding a way to end a fight against a superior force. Combat needs to be a multiple-choice scenario. Players need to have several options both in how to engage enemies and how the combat ends. In my video on terrain, I talked about how players need to be able to choose from several different strategies to overcome their foes. We're going to be building on that concept again this week. I would recommend watching the terrain video after this, because the two concepts really work hand in hand. I play a lot of D&D, just so you know my background, but this advice is system neutral and can be applied to any game. In every combat, there is always an objective. However, the vast majority of combat encounters revolve around the same objective, which is simply...
kill them all!
Yeah! Oh yeah!
There is definitely a place for that type of encounter in any game, but variety is the spice of life. Why force ourselves to play out that same fight over and over again? In a standard fight, the best approach is always to do a ton of damage as quickly as possible. But what about when doing more damage doesn't always help the objective? Those are the situations we want to explore, the things that force our players to try unique tactics. To achieve this, I've got a simple 3-step recipe that will forever keep your combat interesting. Step 1. Choose a subject or multiple subjects. A subject is what your objective or win condition is focused around. There are 3 types of subjects. First, you have the very important person or people. The VIP can be your big bad evil guy, or a group of lowly goblins, or it can be a town full of innocent villagers. VIPs can be both good guys and bad guys. Usually, you don't want a group of VIPs much bigger than a few dozen. Remember, we're focusing on combat, and when you get into larger numbers, combat quickly becomes unmanageable. The next subject is the MacGuffin. The MacGuffin is your plot device. It's a quest item that your party is willing to risk their lives over. It can be a rusty sword with sentimental value to your paladin, or it could be a magical artifact capable of destroying the world. The MacGuffin doesn't need to be small, either. Maybe it's a huge airship that the party owns. As long as it is a mobile object, it is your MacGuffin. If it is an immobile object, then it is a location. A location can be of varying size, anywhere from a doorway to a small portal, up to an entire city. Again, remember this is a video about combat, so your location can only scale up so far. Pick a subject that has some tie to the players. You could also consider it to be your party's motivation. If your party has no connection to the subject, they will have no motivation in the encounter.
You ever wonder why we're here? It's one of life's great mysteries, isn't it? Why are we here?
Sure, your party will probably humor you and fight that orc simply because you said orcs are evil and they need to die. But what if the party comes back from an adventure to find that the orcs have raided their hometown and burned down their favorite tavern? Suddenly, your party has a reason to care about these orcs. Now, they have a motivation. Once you've picked your subject, step 2 is to apply an objective. This represents your party's goal in combat, and you can consider this to be your win condition. If a goal is achieved, the combat is won, and there are 4 broad categories of objectives, the first of which is the most common, destroy. Destroy is almost always paired with VIPs as the subject. If your party kicks down a door to find a group of orcs on the other side, the orcs are your VIPs, and the objective is destroy. This is the objective that covers the vast majority of combat encounters in D&D, because, let's face it, isn't this what the game is truly about?
To crush your enemies, see them driven before you, and to hear the lamentation of their women.
But for an example of how broad the destroy objective can be, let's take a look at Star Wars Return of the Jedi. The climax of this movie actually has the destroy objective for all 3 forms of subjects. Han Solo had to destroy a location, the shield generator. Lando had to destroy the MacGuffin, the Death Star, while Luke had to destroy a VIP, the Emperor. And once each goal was achieved, the fight was over. The stormtroopers surrendered, the remaining Imperial fleet was leaderless and retreated, and Darth Vader was redeemed. Just because your party's objective is to destroy does not mean they need to kill every enemy. Dragons will fly away when wounded. Kobolds will scatter when leaderless. Goblins will find somewhere to hide. Almost every creature in D&D is smart enough not to throw its life away when it has the opportunity to run. I would say that undead are the only creatures that really keep fighting to the end because they're already at their end and have nothing to lose. Our next objective is protect. Lord of the Rings is chock full of this one. Frodo fights to protect the MacGuffin, the One Ring. Boromir dies to protect the VIPs, Merry and Pippin. Aragorn, Legolas, and Gimli fight to protect Helm's Deep. Protect does have a lot of overlap with destroy, because it's easiest to protect your subject when all the bad guys are dead. That's okay, your party gets to decide the best way to achieve their objective. We just give them options. Sometimes, protect means that the party wants to retreat. It'll be one of the few times that a party will run away from a fight. The next objective is the race. You can be racing to or from your subject. It also doesn't need to be fast-paced. If you're racing from a VIP, maybe there's a giant gelatinous cube slowly pushing forward down a long hallway, with your players just in front. They'll need to solve the puzzle to open the door if they want to survive. For a race to a location, maybe your party wants to warn a nearby town of an incoming hobgoblin invasion, starting a chase scene where your party is being harried by warg cavalry the whole way. Your party doesn't need to kill all of the cavalry, and if they waste turns trying, they may not reach the town with enough time to help. For a race to a MacGuffin, let's say your party is searching for a magic gem at the bottom of a mega dungeon, but there are rival adventurers after the same loot, and the rivals have a head start. Now your party will have to carefully consider how much time to devote to each monster if they wish to get that sweet, sweet loot. Our last objective is capture. Indiana Jones is the perfect example for capturing a MacGuffin. The Golden Idol, the Ark of the Covenant, the Holy Grail, that weird alien skull thingy. He grabs the item before the Nazis and commies get a chance because
it belongs in a museum!
Capturing a VIP, on the other hand, can create the most memorable encounters because your players can't attack at full strength. Say your party needs to capture a kobold shaman. One stray hit could easily kill that little guy, even at low levels. They'll have to use some sort of weak melee attack to knock him out or somehow persuade him into giving himself up, all while contending with the massive traps and minions surrounding him. We want to create unique scenarios like this that have multiple outcomes and solutions. Objectives are not mutually exclusive. You can combine any objectives to create an encounter with even more layers. For example, let's say we want to combine a capture objective with a race objective. And this can create a scenario where your party has to open a gate inside a fort in order to let allies inside before they are mowed down while vulnerable outside the walls. If your party succeeds, they now have allies to help with their mission. If the party fails, they fight on alone. When an objective is reached, you might lead this into a new objective. Continuing this scenario, once your party manages to open that gate, then we'll shift their objectives to protect the location and destroy the VIPs. And we'll do this by having the remaining hostiles at the gate regroup while a captain yells for runners to go alert reinforcements. Now your party has to continue to defend the gate and keep it open while preventing the runners from escaping and alerting more enemies. After that, we'll shift the objectives to capture the VIPs and protect the VIPs. This has now become an escort mission where your party moves deeper into the fort to rescue or capture the hostages and then must protect the hostages while safely extracting them from the fort. This is made much more difficult if the runners got away earlier because those reinforcements are just now arriving. Shifting objectives during a combat makes the world feel dynamic and immersive. Suddenly, there is a continuity to multiple skirmishes, and there are real stakes to deal with. Your party sees tangible rewards for succeeding at objectives, but also sees the consequences of failing an objective. It also prevents longer combats from feeling like a slog. With the circumstances changing so often, your players will be engaged the entire fight. After choosing the subjects and objectives, we add in yet one more final layer. Step 3 is the complication. There is an infinite number of complications. Your imagination is the limit. But I've got a few broad ideas to get you started. First is the buff or the nerf. Say your party's objective is to kill two twin mages. This is a standard destroy the VIP's objective. But what if those twin mages give each other damage boosts or some sort of protection spell while in close proximity? Now your party is encouraged to either put distance between the mages or focus fire on a single mage to take them out one at a time. Maybe your party's objective is to protect an ally performing a ritual to cleanse an unholy altar. The catch is that the runes around the altar prevent your party from using healing spells. Your clerics now need to leave the safety of the group if they wish to work their magic. My next complication for you, I call the Fifth Dawn.
Look to my coming, at first light on the fifth day.
This is when your party is fighting for a predetermined amount of time against insurmountable odds. Now, your party doesn't need to actually be fighting for 5 days. It can be short as 3 or 4 rounds. but your party will need to hold out for some reason. Maybe reinforcements are on the way, or a ritual needs time to be completed. This will encourage your party to use defensive tactics and slow down the enemy. You could have a continuous stream of enemies, or you could have several small combat encounters, with enough time in between waves for a short rest, but not a long rest. Either way, your party will realize this is a war of attrition, and plan accordingly. Another complication is horde mode. This is when enemies will continue to spawn until the objective is achieved. You could have several open portals summoning creatures from another plane every turn, and your party must use the MacGuffin to close the portals, but the summoned creatures know that, and target whoever is holding the MacGuffin first. Things will quickly get out of hand if your party can't close the portals fast enough. The stereotypical horde mode is a necromancer that, until slain, will continually spawn undead. This can be fun, but it's a bit predictable. Let's make a subversion of this trope by having the horde not interested in your party. The necromancer is now commanding his zombies to attack the nearby village, and your party must both try to save the villagers and defeat the necromancer to stop the horde. The dilemma is when your party has multiple objectives, but only one can be achieved at the cost of the other. Maybe your party's objectives are to kill the big bad evil guy and rescue the hostage. Your party will think it's pretty convenient when they're both in the same room. Two birds with one stone, right? But once combat begins, it is revealed that the villain cast a spell that shares damage between the two. Now your party has to choose to either save the hostage or kill the villain. My final complication for you is the phylactery. For those of you new to D&D, a lich is an undead mage that hides their soul in an artifact called a phylactery. But what if a living villain found a way to tie their life force to a MacGuffin as well? After the fight begins, your party will be damaging the villain to no avail. Soon, your party will realize that a nearby artifact is protecting the villain. Destroying that artifact is the key to winning the fight. To sum it all up, you start with a subject that your party is invested in, then you pick an objective as your win condition, and then you top it off with some complications to create a unique fight. By adding several layers of meaning to your combat, we create more options for our players, and this in turn encourages our players to try out new tactics and strategies. Be sure that the objectives and complications are open-ended. Combat should be a puzzle with multiple solutions, and having multiple solutions includes the possibility of failing the objective. This keeps your players invested in the outcome of the fight, as there are real consequences. If you look back at all the sessions you've played, you'll be shocked at how many combat encounters have no bearing on the story. And we want to avoid these copy-paste fights as often as possible. This might sound like a lot of prep for each combat, I get it. And for some games, it's more than enough to say you kill the orc because it's evil. But if you really want to up the stakes for both your story and your combat, you need to give your players more meaningful objectives. I hope you find this video helpful. If you did, please consider subbing to my channel. I do not monetize these videos. I find fulfillment entirely in fake internet points. Don't forget to check out my terrain video as it ties in very nicely with the objectives. I'll link it right here for you. If you have suggestions for future videos or want to tell me just how bad my current videos are, hit me up on Twitter at StephenTheDM. My next video will be a monsterology video where I do a deep dive into the tactics behind D&D's most iconic monsters. Thanks for watching, and until next time, I'm Stephen the DM.